Can you hear me?
Just,
are we live?
We are, yes.
Okay.
Oh, we're live? Okay. My apologies. Good morning. I would like to call this meeting of the October 30th Assiniboia Community Committee meeting to order. First, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Treaty 1 territory, the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. I am joined by my council colleagues, Councillor Janice Lukes, who is on Zoom today. And to my left is Councillor Scott Gillingham from the St. James Ward. Also, I would like to acknowledge we have several members of the public service joining us today and thank them for their time and effort today to be here. And for those of you watching at home, we have a few, we have a public hearing to go through. We have some motions to move. We also will have some delegations appearing before us. But before we get started, I need to have somebody move a motion to approve the meeting notes from our last meeting. So moved by Councillor Gillingham. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's carried. So, Madam Clerk, I will let you start with the delegations.
So the first delegation will be heard with respect to Report 5. It's Craig and Kelly Heglin. And they're joining us via Zoom.
Hi, Craig.
I think your audio is still connecting, Craig.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Hello.
Hi there. You can proceed with your presentation.
Okay. I got a written one here. It says, okay. Can you hear me okay?
I just need you to mute the YouTube stream if you're watching on YouTube. There's a bit of a delay.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Is that better?
Yep, we can hear and see you.
Okay, awesome. So good day, members of the committee. I'm sure my letter of intent clearly describes my request. I am simply wishing to receive your support in allowing an extra 3 feet of width to be added to the 21 feet allotted by code to be the maximum width of my driveway at the property line. It used to be approximately 28 feet wide at the property line and about 35 feet wide at the street. But I have now since jackhammered and removed a significant portion to come into compliance. Previously, the inspector had requested a curb to define the sidewalk from the driveway, but has since revisited the site and verbally he has agreed with me that the curb would be redundant. I have included pictures of other homes in the area that are meant to be to simply add clarity to what I have done and what the driveway looks like and functions like. I have also included a picture of a similar driveway on my street that has more concrete directly in front. Or sorry, I don't think you have that one, but I wasn't able to get that to you in time, but I do have a picture of it. I can put it in front of the camera here, but it's basically shows another one that has got no curb defining the sidewalk between the driveway and the actual sidewalk. And then, okay. They also do not have a curb. Other pictures I have provided simply add credence to my statements that parking on my street is at a premium, to which I have simply made it possible for myself not to take up valuable street parking. And that's pretty much my request.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you to your lovely assistant helping you with the technical issues. It's always nice to have. Any questions for my colleagues? Councillor Lukes.
So, excuse me. So I see that the department is supporting this non-conforming approach. And I see you have removed your gravel parking, or has it been removed? Or the
yes, there's a picture of it that I've actually removed the gravel from the portion. There is a picture. You do have a picture there that shows how I removed a substantial section of my driveway to come into compliance. And then there is another picture. Just bear with me, please. It's of the boulevard. You should have a picture there somewhere of the boulevard.
Yeah.
Did I fix the boulevard?
Yep.
Okay, that's great. Yeah, so I have fixed the boulevard since then and brought it back to, well, unfortunately I couldn't get the grass to grow yet. That'll have to happen in the spring, but it is back to mud and has been seeded.
Sure. And I don't, the sidewalk is a curb sidewalk. Is that what you're saying? Like the sidewalk, is there a sidewalk? Like you were talking about a sidewalk.
At the property line, the conforming distance for a driveway is 21 feet.
Right.
At the property line. What I have actually there is 24 feet.
Right.
Okay. So what I'm asking the committee to agree to is that the extra 3 feet be allotted to be sidewalk. Because when you park two cars appropriately side by each, it's nice to have an actual sidewalk to get to the front street. Please remember that I do not have back lane access, and everybody on our street has to wheel their recycle bins and garbage bins forward to the street weekly for pickup. And it would make it difficult with vehicles in there and have to trudge that through the snow.
Sure.
And if I put a curb there, that's just to define the sidewalk from the driveway. It's kind of redundant because it's just going to make it harder to clean the snow and really becomes a trip hazard.
Sure. Okay, I'm fine with this.
Thank you, Councilor Gillingham.
No, I'm fine with this. I saw Delwood, and my ears perked up because the first home I ever had was on Delwood. So there we go. Lot back, a lot of memories. Good memories. Good community.
Craig, just for clarity, when you're talking about sidewalk, you're talking about the walkway to your home, correct?
That's correct. Yeah.
Okay, so not a traditional sidewalk that we could think of along the street or an ATR.
That's correct. Yes.
Thanks. And have you spoken to your neighbors about this?
Yes, everybody's fine about it. They're actually surprised I had to remove what I did, but I explained to them, I guess I got a little overzealous in my pouring of the concrete there and had to come back into compliance, and they went, oh, that's cool. So,
well, you know what, thank you very much for working with the public service on this, and thanks for your presentation today. I don't think we have any other questions, and we'll of course vote on it later, but I think we need everything from you we've already had. So thank you very much.
That's awesome. You guys.
I'm just hanging on before you go, Craig. We don't have any other delegations. Can we move this up and then they can know now? Okay. So we can just read the motion in if you would like to take the chair.
Yeah, for sure. So, okay. I'll turn it to Councilor Klein then.
So yeah, I would just move that the motion for the non-conforming approach at 72 Delwood Crescent be approved or concur with the public service to be approved.
Okay, motion to concur in the approval. All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? It is carried. Thank you.
There you go, sir.
Well, that's awesome. You guys stay safe and have a great day.
You too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
That's fine.
Thank you very much, Councilor Gillingham. So there's no further delegations. We can move on to reports. Is that correct, Madam Clerk? So we'll start with Councilor Gillingham's citizen member appointments.
Okay. The for item number one, three citizens for a 2-year term to expire December 31st, 2022. I think, Madam Clerk, you had sent a list of names prior to. And so do you have those names that you can, are they read into the record at this point, or because we'd like to approve concurrence in those?
Is the committee's wish to appoint all three of those individuals to the Library Advisory Committee Board?
I'm that's my motion, but I'm open to any changes, amendments that council may have. I see Council Luke may have a question there.
Council Luke?
So this call to go out on boards and committees was the very large call that went out, I think, what, like 6 or 8 weeks ago?
Approximately, yes.
Okay, so, and the only people we had responding were from the St. James area?
That's correct.
Okay, and I mean, I didn't do a personal push out on my social media to see if anyone was interested. I mean, there's only so much you can push out, or you're pushing it out all the time. Nothing wrong with having three St. James people on it, but I kind of would like to see a little bit more representation from other parts of the wards. And just so you're clear, Councillor Gillingham, no problem with St. James people, okay? Just want to see a little distribution throughout the ward. So I guess my question to the clerk is, can we have another 4 weeks to see if we can round up someone and come back to the committee?
You could lay the matter over for 30 days, yes, if you'd like.
I'll withdraw my motion then, if the councillor would like.
Councillor Klein, do you have anyone, or have you pushed this out in your...
You know, I put it out through, I have three advisory boards in each of our unique neighborhoods, and I just put that out and haven't followed up with a lot of them. So I support, I have, again, the three people that have applied, follow the system, they follow protocol. I have no issue with that. I have no issue with your concept of waiting 4 weeks, because I like that as well.
I have one question that, yes, I can ask of the clerk. Is it possible to add a fourth member? Can we have three now and then perhaps add a fourth?
There are only three citizen vacancies currently.
Okay.
So we would be filling all of those vacant positions. We would appoint the three individuals who applied.
Okay. All right. You know, Councilman, I'll defer to Council Lutz on this, because I do appreciate her desire for, you know, kind of some representation from across the broader community. Right.
Well, you know what, if you could give me till next meeting, if we could lay it over, I'll just push it out on social media, see if there's an interest. We don't even have a library in the ward, but I've got a lot of keen people, you know, that could bring, you know, perspectives to the committee that maybe we don't have. That's my preference, but if we laid it over for a month.
Well, I think you have, each one of us are in agreement with that. There's no rush to putting this through, according to our clerk and such. So if that's the motion, is to just lay this over for 30 days, we'll just call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Can I ask the clerk one more question? Madam Clerk, is there sort of a job description or something you could send, or is it on the web?
It was posted on the city's website. There is an application page I can forward to you if you'd like.
That would be great. Thank you so much.
So let's finish the voting part. Any opposed? Hearing none, carried.
All right.
Sorry, I just want to make sure we got through it. Maybe I'll pass the chair to Councillor Gillingham for the next one.
Thank you. Item number two, citizen member appointment, St. James Memorial Board, Historical Museum of St. James Assiniboia.
Thank you very much. This is the an appointment that we do every year. We have four citizens that would be appointed to a 2-year term to expire on December 31st, 2022. You have the names and their details before you, and it's been on the agenda for the past several days. And I would just like to move approval of all four as appointees to the St. James Assiniboia Museum Board, the Historical Museum of St. James Assiniboia.
Just to confirm, Councillor, that's Donna Johnson, Mary Longbottom, Clarence Nepenak, and Ingrid Nisnik for a two-year term to expire December 31st of 2022.
That's correct, Madam Clerk.
Okay, that is the motion. All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? Carried. Thank you. I'll turn the chair back to Councillor Klein.
And it's going to go over to you for the next motion.
Ping pong. Yes, Gransel Mill, citizen member appointments. So I see here the six citizens for a 2-year term to expire December 31st, 2022. one citizen for the balance of a two-year term to expire December 31st, 2021. So I have six names here, and I believe if Madam Clerk can just clarify, can these six be appointed to the two-year term?
Yes, if you'd like. There are seven vacancies, so with only six applicants, one position would be left vacant. If you'd like to leave that as the term that's the balance of the term, we can certainly do that.
Let's do that then, please. So these are the individuals. Ken Fluto, Stacey Jones, Christopher Keo, Reg Sims, Colleen Smith, and Layla Yesman. And these, I'll just take a moment to say, these individuals, many of them whom I've worked with on this board before, served with, just do an outstanding job of promoting, caring for Grants Old Mill and its history. So I'll move these individuals as six citizens for the two-year appointment. So moved.
Any comments, questions, Councilor Lutz?
Nope, that's great.
Excellent. That's great. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. We'll move on to item four now, which is the per capita grant for the Winnipeg Art Gallery. I'll note that through my per capita grant already, or the Charles and Tuxedo per capita grant to be specific, we've already given the Art Gallery $500 this year for their request, planning to give another $500 in 2021 as to break it up so that we were able to accommodate more requests. So I will not be donating at this one, but I will leave the rest of the floor for my colleagues to add their thoughts. Councilor Lutz?
Well, at this time of year, I'm always scraping the bottom of the barrel. So I would put $250 of per capita towards the Winnipeg Art Gallery. I know that's not a lot, but, you know, I'm like I said, at the end of the year, I'm scraping the bottom of the barrel.
We all are.
And I would, I believe I have sufficient funds. I am confident I do. And so I will provide $500 to assist with the costs of the celebration events during the opening week of the Inuit Art Center.
Excellent. We don't have to have any votes on that, correct?
We do, yes.
Oh, we do.
So just need a mover for the motion and then a formal.
Okay, I can move that $500 from St. James per capita. And $250 from Waverly West.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. We've already dealt with item five, the non-conforming approach. Item six, active transportation connection from Northtown Road to El Dorado Boulevard. I believe this is Councillor Lutz. This is your ward?
It is, yes. And I just submitted to the clerk, and I copied you, counselors, on some images. This, I'm just asking for the department to come back to our committee and give us a verbal update. I don't need a full report or anything. I just want to understand the opportunities and challenges. I mean, if they want to make a report, that's great, but I'd like it to come back to this committee on a connection through what everyone assumes is a hydro corridor between White Ridge and, I'm going to call it, Bridgewater Lakes. It's actually all of the Bridgewaters, but I think you folks are familiar with it. There's a drain that goes through there. There used to be an old rail line that goes through there. When I started researching it, there's like dozens of little parcels of land individually owned by people. So there is an opportunity. There's two openings on either side of the communities. While there is an active transportation path, it's about 2 kilometers long that goes along Keniston. This connection would be 600 meters from one community to the next. And it does cross a drainage drain. I've been involved prior to being elected in putting in bridges. Councillor Gillingham, you have one over Silver. You know the bridge by the community gardens there for the Yellow Ribbon Greenway or Yellow Ribbon Greenway Path. So yep. This is the, you know, and those structures are not inexpensive. So there's two other ones in South Winnipeg and St. Vital area-ish that we put in over the years. And this is a similar drain, not as big, but I just would like, I've had lots of requests. There's lots of families whose kids go to schools in White Ridge, and you know, they don't want to send them on the 2 kilometer one. They want them just to go across through the field. So I just said I'd investigate it. And this is what the request is.
Okay. Comments, questions, Councillor Dillingham?
No, I think a report or backer, a verbal report would be helpful here to make any decision as far as what may be possible.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm Councillor Luke, you know, in most cases, I'm not a fan of verbal reports because it's difficult for, you know, looking back and having that detail when you go back. But for somebody, obviously, this is your initial look at it. So I'm certainly supportive of that. Absolutely. I think it's a good first step. So.
Yeah. And I know there'll be big costs and everything. And I know the department is very, very busy. But I thought a verbal report, we'll have it on video. I can share it with my residents. And, you know, I know it's going to be in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I just don't want the department to be having to do a big full out, you know.
No, it's very reasonable.
I am a reasonable person, Councillor Klein, surprisingly.
I'd like to, we'll vote on this one first and then we're going to vote on that.
Can I abstain?
Public service wants to vote too. Okay, so all in favor of the motion that Councillor Luke's has tabled?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. And I'll turn the chair back to Councillor Gillingham because he's right to the left for the next one.
Item 7, three-way stop at West Taylor Boulevard and Shaftesbury Boulevard.
So I'm hoping you received, I know that the clerk, Madam Clerk, had sent some digital photos to you, and I brought some color ones with a circle. Unfortunately, I thought you were in person today, Councillor Luke, but you do have the digital ones. So this is really an important section. If you've driven down Shaftesbury lately, Shaftesbury from Grant to Wilkes has become the 401. At 5 o'clock on a Friday. It's jammed. You have two high schools that are on that road. You don't, you have the forest, you have the university, and you don't have a sidewalk from Taylor to Wilkes, but you have park access at Wilkes and you have park access at Taylor. And there's the main bike path that a lot of people get on and the residents will feed into come from Taylor. What we're finding now is that it is very unsafe for people to cross because cars will see there's no train and of course want to get there before a train does come. So the speed is accelerating and people are having a difficult time to cross. We've looked at this for quite some time. And, you know, after several emails and conversations with area residents, we felt that the easiest way to do this, because there are people that want to turn on to Taylor or from Taylor on to Shaftesbury towards Wilkes, which I would be south. It's very difficult to do at peak times. Now, there are times when it's not that difficult, but when it's an open road, it's a very long stretch of road. So the speeds tend to be a little faster. The crosswalk here will allow people to access the forest. And I think that's a really important function because on that side of the road, on the west side, all along Shaftesbury, there is no sidewalk. There's nothing. It's curbed forest. So people are driving along a very small or a very narrow patch of land, if you will, once they can get across to get to the entrance to the park. I think the crosswalk will, you know, encourage them to go and cross safely and will allow and reduce the risk of pedestrians or cyclists being hit. So I'm moving today that the public service put that in there. And the reason is because I think we all know use of our active transportation routes and especially Assiniboine Forest has increased because of COVID. And we're not out of it yet. I think we've got, you know, many more months of this to deal with. And I think this would be very helpful to the residents. And I think it's long overdue considering the amount of traffic. The area is growing along Wilkes and people will use Shaftesbury, pardon me, to get to McCreary then get into White Ridge and so on, because they miss the traffic of Keniston and such. So hopefully the pictures give you enough detail. You know, they say a picture's worth a thousand words. Hopefully that, in this case, it is. And I'm just looking for your support to have the public service put the three-way stop there, which I think would be safest.
Okay. Any questions at all?
Oh, lots. I got lots.
Okay.
I'm really, really glad you brought this up. Okay. I'm just looking now. Did the clerk send the pictures, Councillor Klein, or what? Like,
yes, Madam Clerk.
Got it. Okay. Okay. So let me tell you about this strip here. You have no idea how happy I am you brought this up, because this has been on my to-do list for a while to talk to you, and haven't got to it, but okay.
Mission in life is to make you happy.
Okay. So here's the deal. So, so I go to the Shaftesbury residence on a regular basis, because my stepdad of 30 years is at the Shaftesbury. So we go to the Shaftesbury all the time. And then I cut through and I go to Sergeant's Sunday, a very popular ice cream store over there. Okay. So what I've observed about this stretch, okay, I've observed a couple things. Number one, on the west side along Assiniboine Forest and along the east side of Shaftesbury, there is a void of pathway connection.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, you know, the sidewalk starts up by West Taylor in and around there, which is all fine. But you can see the desire line. It's like a highway of pounded ground on the north side of Shaftesbury. Now, many, many times when I'm at the intersection, either waiting for a train or at the intersection, especially when there's a train, you see a buildup of pedestrians and cyclists on McCreary or on Shaftesbury, you know, waiting for the train. They're flowing out of the Hart Trail. They're flowing off of the Thundering Bison Trail. They're with all this density that's being put in, they're coming from everywhere. Mm-hmm. And there's a terrible missing link to get to, from a pedestrian standpoint along Shaftesbury. So yeah, I'll support your stop signs. That's great. That's great. Let's do that. But I don't know if you want to make a separate motion, or I'll make a separate motion. You should, it's your ward, but I could still do it. I would like the department to see what the cost is of putting an active transportation pathway connecting Grant to Wilkes.
So an active transportation, what you're talking about on the west side by the port.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we can move that as new business, if that's okay. I would like to do that as well. We have had that discussion a few times, and trying to look at funds within our, you know, our ward allowances, different ways to make that happen. But I think that's necessary, because you're right. Along the west side, as I noted, there it's just, you know, it's beaten down grass and dirt, yeah, that people are walking on and driving on. And there's very, I would say, and I don't think it's an exaggeration, because I do drive that area a lot. I live in that area. There's probably 7 inches from that path to the roadway.
Yeah.
Families that ride their bikes on there, there's kids that ride their bikes on there, and so on. And then you've got the university, and we have such a beautiful forest, but we're not surrounding it with the right tools, if you will, to really enjoy the forest. And I think that the connection along there is a great idea. I would certainly love to see that. So I appreciate that support, and I'm happy to move that motion as a new motion once we get to the end of the meeting.
Yeah, and I mean, the whereas is, like, I have a long history on active transportation, and when we put in the Thundering Bison Trail, in and around the same time, we got funding for that extension of the Hart Trail also to go through. That was part of a federal funding grant. So that connection was made, but the density in that neighborhood has increased like tenfold with all the apartments and things. And then with the university too, right? And even though we have a trail going through Assiniboine Forest, this is more, you can see the desire line is much more of a commuter trail, because then they go straight through, they go over the bridge, and they're in St. James, right? So So it's a really big missing gap. I wanted to look up first to see if it was in the pedestrian and cycling strategies as a recommendation. And that's sort of been my delay on getting around to it. Right. If we can bring a motion forward like that, huge, you know, and I know Councillor Klein, you're sitting on a nice pile of money that you maybe could sweeten the pot with at some point, but you know, it's a highly desired connection, as you can see. So that's one thing. Now let's talk about the second thing. Okay. So the second thing, and this has happened to me and it's happened to members of my family who've told me about this. And at first I didn't believe it. And then it happened to me and it was like, oh my goodness. Right. So if you're traveling south towards McCreary, but you're stopped at the rail line. So you're stopped at the rail line because the trains are going by. There's two sets of lights. There's a set of lights right around the Hart Trail area that you stop for. And then on the other side of the train, there's a set of lights also. So if you're looking at it, if you go in and look at it on your Google map.
I'm well aware of it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So what happens is the train goes by, which is all great. And then the light on the south side of Shaftesbury part, it turns green, but the light on the north side of the train stays red. But people don't, they just drive through that. So I've talked to Patman about this. It's something to do with synchronization. And often I've seen cops sitting there waiting and they get people, right? Which, you know, you're not supposed to go through a red light, but you're sitting at the red light, the train goes, then you see the green light, so you go, right? The arms come up and you go. So maybe it's supposed to be like that. I've seen this happen countless times, and I've again been meaning to ask Mr. Patman to do just sort of an investigation on the timing of the two sets of lights north and south of the train line, rail line.
I can speak to that for you, and I'm happy to, because it is an issue. First of all, it's not Winnipeg Police that we give the ticket, it's CN Police that are usually there.
Wow.
And so I've asked Mr. Patman as well and CN to look into it. And I think you know the young group, the young entrepreneurs in the city of that have a system they developed for warning people about trains and traffic and all that kind of stuff. But CN right now is working in conjunction, I believe, hopefully, putting together a report that would be hand it over to Mr. Papin so that they can find a better way for those lights to sync up. I understand why the second light is there. It's because they don't want somebody getting stopped on the tracks. So the north side lights before the tracks turns red, obviously, earlier so that it can ensure that there's no cars that get stuck on the tracks. The other direction, you're right. Normally, it should be at the same time, but we're not seeing that. So it is in the hands of Mr. Patman. It is being looked at. And the reason that it is being looked at is another motion that I sent out to you guys earlier that we're going to talk about in a couple of minutes. So.
Okay, good. Because that's great. Okay.
So we have this one motion before us related to the idea of putting Port West Taylor and Shaftesbury. I think we're good with that. I certainly will support this going to the committee, standing committee. So I'll call the question on that then. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Then what I'll do maybe is if there's another motion coming, should we have do we need a suspension of the rules to hear a motion?
Yeah.
I think we do, right? So Councillor Lukes moves suspension of the rules. All in favor? Aye. I'll turn to Councillor Klein then, maybe for a motion related to the active transportation pathway.
I think we have the whereases, and Councillor Lukes and Councillor Gillingham, please feel free to jump in on the whereases. But I believe the number one whereas would be, whereas there is no connection from Grant to Wilkes along the west side of Shaftesbury, there's no active transportation connection for the many residents, cyclists, and others that need access to the forest or would desire access to the forest. And given the increase, and whereas the increase in density of
the Charleswood Tuxedo Westwood Ward, specifically in the area of surrounding the forest, if you will, and also west of the forest in the Ridgewood area, the increased use of the Hart Trail, and of course the increased residential units on Wilkes closer to the outlet mall. We need to be looking at an improvement to our connection to our active transportation route. And whereas there is no connection east or west on Shaftesbury for active transportation, walking, cycling, none. That would be south of Taylor to Wilkes. There is nothing there. And oddly, there's a crosswalk at the lights at Wilkes and Shaftesbury, but there's no connection from south of Taylor to Wilkes or on the east or west side. I would ask that the public service report back to IRPW or to this committee, because I might have to use the funds through a different source to get this done. So maybe back to this committee, and then we can look at LDR.
Madam Clerk, do we have to get, I think, the report to the standing committee, or can it come here first?
You could request that the public service report back to this committee, depending on what the recommendation is within that report. It may need to be a recommendation back to standing committee from Assiniboia, but you could certainly request that.
So it should come here first, depending on what the recommendation is, and then we can find out where the funding would come. Okay.
You can. That's a request to the standing committee, so they would have to concur to send the report back here. But if they do, then this is where the report would come in. Then, depending on the recommendations within that report, it may need to go up.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Ben.
Council Lutz, do you have a question there?
No, that's good. Yeah, it's good. Like, it's good on things like this. If you want to talk to the department, it's good to bring it back to committee, because it's impossible to talk to the department at RPW, right? So.
Great. Okay. Okay, that is the motion. All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? Carried. Thank you. I'll turn the chair back over to Council Klein.
So we still have a couple of other items for new business, Madam Clerk. So disappointed clerk, can we continue with those right now, or should we go to the hearing portion?
We cannot stop or start the public hearing until 10:30. So if the committee would like to proceed with the new business motions, as long as there's a motion to suspend the rules for new business.
But you want to do Council?
Well, I have a motion too.
Yeah, so let's Councillor Gillingham already has a chair. If you don't mind, Councillor Lutz, so we'll just bang the one off that I have. I think I have one in there, correct, or two? I have two.
Yes, there's two from Councillor Klein and an additional report from Councillor Lutz. So just need a motion to suspend the rules to hear those three items of new business.
Okay, Councillor Klein moves suspension of the rules. All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? Carried. Thank you. Councillor Klein, to you.
So the two new the first one that I have is really more of a budget one, and we don't have to get into a big debate about this. But if you go back into history, the city organizational bylaw 7197, the operating and capital budgets are referred to the executive policy committee, two standing committees for consideration to make recommendations only on the subject matter within the committee's jurisdiction. The current budget review process limits the ability of councillors to ask questions and of the public service and provide input, limited input on subject matter outside of the jurisdiction of the committee they may sit on. The current budget review process the first one had more public participation, less this time, as it does force citizens to attend up to six separate meetings if they want to provide input on different budget areas. And that's difficult for a lot of people in this day and age. The City of Winnipeg Act previously required, so when we first developed Unicity and the Act first came into place to meet the needs of the many communities that came together as one, the Act required that each community committee shall conduct a meeting or meetings to facilitate participation by residents of the community in the preparation of submissions concerning the annual current and capital budgets. The city organizational bylaw 7197 states that community committees operate as previously stipulated in the former City of Winnipeg Act, except, so it was changed, except with the respect to the preparation or consideration of the operating budgets, the capital budget, or the five-year capital expenditure programs of the city. This wording hasn't been changed, I'll note, to reflect any consideration of a four-year plan. So the original intent of the City of Winnipeg and Unicity was to ensure that we involved all jurisdictions, all communities that came together as one, and gave all the communities a voice, an opportunity to be heard, to speak to their individual councillors on the budget process. It gave an opportunity for councillors to hear firsthand what's happening from the departments. So I would like it to be considered and be it resolved that the city organizational bylaw 7197 be amended to require community committees to consider and make recommendations to the executive policy committee on the operating and capital budgets. My assumption is this will go to governance, but.
This would go to EPC.
Oh, it would go to EPC, which would probably direct it to governance, I would think. Because it's part of governance.
EPC would make recommendations with respect to bylaws. So this would fall under their jurisdiction. And it's a budget matter ultimately.
Okay. So the purpose of this is inclusion. And not to get into information battles or discussions. This is just more about let's open it up more. Let's be inclusive and let's have residents to join us. Like, let's bring them into this circle a little bit more and give councillors that have been elected by those residents an opportunity to do their job. Sit down with their residents and explain to them what's going on and receive their feedback and bring it back and or use the feedback to base their vote upon. I think it's a good debate to have, and I think it's a good discussion to have, and I hope that my colleagues will let it move forward to see where it will end up at the end of the day.
Okay, that is the motion. Thank you, Councillor Klein. Councillor Lukes, any comments on that?
Did you send it? Oh, you sent it. Yep. Here it is. Okay, sorry. Okay. No, that's fine. I'm supportive.
Okay. I appreciate it. I won't support it for these reasons. I think at the heart of it, which I appreciate, is a desire to have public feedback through the community committees. Participation by residents, facilitate participation by residents of the community in preparation for submissions concerning annual, current, and capital budgets, operating in capital budgets. I think there is opportunity that each of us have to get feedback from, present to, and get feedback from our respective residents. I know Councillor Klein has just indicated he's got the three respective kind of advisory groups within his ward. There's I have regular dialogue with members of our community and channels to speak to the community and hear from the community. So I guess I believe at this time there is ample opportunity to get input from community residents and through the channels that we currently have, whether it's on the standing committees that we sit on, the various standing committees we sit on, or other access that we have to opportunities and avenues to speak to and communicate with administration and other councillors. I believe right now there's sufficient opportunity to have the participation of the residents in the budget process. So that's my view. Obviously, my view is different than other views, so that's completely fine. But so I will call for the question then on this to have it go to executive policy committee, right, clerk? Okay. All in favor of it going to executive policy committee? Aye.
Aye.
Two and opposed.
One. Can't vote twice.
No. I just call aye. Calling aye. All in favor, say aye. Opposed, no. No. Or nay. So okay. That motion passes. Motion number two related to.
This is what I want to go fast so Councilor Luke has time to get hers in.
Sure. Okay.
This one is the intersection improvements at Wilkes and Elmhurst. Wilkes and Elmhurst in 2019 and before has been a problem. There have been a number of accidents, and I have several emails and social media posts and phone calls that we've been tracking that I can share with several members of council. It is probably, well, according to our traffic study, one of the most dangerous intersections in the city. When I first asked for the traffic report and speaking to Mr. Papman, they wanted to see traffic lights put at Wilkes and Elmhurst. They felt that it was a necessity. But at that time, council wasn't allowing that, and it was not approved. Now, there is a minimum cross street volume threshold consideration for traffic control signals, and it's 75 vehicles per hour, and that doesn't include the right turns, for at least 6 hours a day. In the administrative report that I've given you, dated August 14th, 2019, the Winnipeg Public Service identified the intersection of Wilkes and Elmhurst as having a count of 95 vehicles per hour. That's an average. In the administrative report dated again August 14th, 2019, the Winnipeg Public Service indicated that in order to meet design standards, engineering best practices, operate effectively, and reduce future throwaway costs, the Wilkes Avenue roadway would need to be upgraded and properly acquisition would be required to upgrade that intersection. So there's a little bit of land that would have to be acquired there. The Class 5 estimates outlined in the administrative report estimated the intersection improvements at this location would cost approximately $2.5 million. And necessary traffic signals, which are estimated at $300,000. In 1986, this council passed a resolution amending the city's development agreement parameters. This is Councillor Bill Clements, who I still hear about every day. And Mr. Clement would have done. And I wish I was half the man he was. So imposing the Charleswood Transportation Levy that passed in 1986. You're going to start feeling like we're talking about the future services account in a moment. In an attempt to resolve some of the inequalities of the street system in Charleswood so that development could occur. The monies collected from the Charleswood Transportation Levy are intended to fund projects directly related to regional transportation issues. That would be Elmhurst and Wilkes. Therefore, and we've looked at the account, I've talked to the departments, therefore be it resolved that the Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works be requested to direct the public service to utilize funds from the Charleswood Transportation Levy to undertake the necessary intersection improvements at Wilkes Avenue and Elmhurst identified in the administrative report dated August 14th, 2019. That money can't be used for anything else. And it's been sitting there for years and years and years. Mm-hmm. And from what I understand, again, the interest from that money is going to general revenues. This is a serious problem. Just 2 weeks ago, an 18-wheeler turning was hit by a car. So bad, the 18-wheeler flipped on its side. Luckily, there was no fatalities in there. But there are accidents there on a regular basis, and it is continuing to get worse as people find faster routes. And that's because of the, you know, the new apps that are available, and because, you know, construction is going on. In fact, we're partly to blame, because we will feed all these apps where construction is, and they tell people where all these quicker routes are, and nine times out of 10, they're through residential areas. We have to deal with this problem. It has gone on long enough. The money's there, and I would like your support to use the money what it's there for, what our former colleague and beloved former colleague, Mr. Bill Clement, wanted it for, and that's to fix transportation issues in our ward That would be Wilkes and Elmhurst, an improved intersection.
Just one question I would have, Council Klein, related to the cost. I do see in the whereas is the class five estimate.
I know.
Is that right though? About 2.5 million in addition to the traffic signal, so 300,000. So approximately 2.8 million without the class five. Obviously they'd refine that, but that's the latest number you have, right?
Yeah. Talking to Mr. Pappin and them, there was a discussion that it actually might be lower because they wouldn't do the expanded one they're talking about now because of other changes that will come down in the future when they're looking at it. So it would be a little, it would probably come down, but I don't want to quote by how much because they haven't done that plan yet. So.
Okay. My other question for you is if this goes to Standing Policy Committee and the monies are available, would this be taken on? I don't know if this has to be taken on as part of the 2021 budget. Would they put it in the 2021 budget? I mean, if you've got a funding source for it, so I guess the Standing Committee probably should find out. I guess it would be included in the 2021 budget.
Well, it's funds that are already there, so I don't think it would be included in the 2021 budget, right? If the funds are standing there for that purpose, they're
yes, but you know what? They have to schedule things in, right? I got a big lecture the other day about it.
Yeah. That's a fair point. Yeah, to schedule it in, yes, but the funds are in the accounts.
Because I'm just wondering if there's any value here. I mean, they could do it at Standing Committee too, but if there's any value here in including the line, if approved or if forwarded to the 21 budget process with this funding source identified.
I think that's a wise inclusion.
I have a question.
Council Luke.
How much is in the Charleswood Transportation Levy?
About 3 million from what I understand. It could be a little more now. It's difficult to get the actual full number, but we've got recent ones that show us about that amount of money.
Yeah, we had the department go through this. This was before you were elected when we were working on the Sterling Line Parkway fiasco. And they provided the fee, like they provided what the value was in the fund. So I just don't recall it off the top of my head. But you're saying you have enough money in that fund to put that intersection in?
That is the belief, yes.
And you're saying the Public Works Department, they gave the report. I think their big thing, and this is, you know, really comes from my whole involvement with the Sterling Line Parkway expansion, was that they want an area plan, really, before they proceed with big investments, right? They want to have a precinct plan.
Right. However, in the new Our Winnipeg, that's changed for that area.
What do you mean?
In the new Our Winnipeg, it's not. It's the South Wilkes area is back. Is back to its a different designation. If you take a look at it. So this.
Well, I mean, I guess we can move it along, and if the department wants to go ahead with it, and you have the money, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I certainly support it going to the Standing Committee to be discussed there and the determination made. Appreciate that a funding source has been found for it as well. That's what it's there for. So it'll be interesting, Council Luke. I appreciate your point at the Standing Committee to see if the department speaks about kind of long-term plans for that area, how eminent those development plans are or not. And so that could certainly determine, you know, whether this needs to be done. If those plans are 15 to 20 years away, the support improvement to an intersection if the funding's there for sure.
Yeah.
So
okay. I think you'll find Public Works in our discussions that they really felt it was necessary.
Yeah.
So this is and again, like if we're gonna make little changes to other things that we're doing at City Hall, we did a lot of that yesterday, little changes, things we're waiting for big plans for. The very first thing we need to do, very first thing, is think about the safety of the citizens and with the number of accidents occurring here and with the fact that we have the report done, we have the experts at the public service saying this is a bad intersection. If we can find we have a funding source, hopefully we can get this included. I understand that the booking part of it being added to the budget makes sense. But yeah, let's move it forward and see what happens.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Carrie, thank you. I'll turn the chair back over to Councillor Klein for Councillor Lutz's motions.
Thank you very much. Councillor Lutz, over to you.
Yeah, so I'm bringing forward a motion. Let me just pull it up here so I can read it. And I sent it to you yesterday. Where is it? Madam Clerk, do you have the motion that you could fire off to me to, oh, here it is, I'm sorry.
Just the snow clearing one?
This is the snow clearing one. So, you know, again, I guess I'm just asking for a verbal report because I know that'll happen faster. People are going to be outside a lot this winter. They're not going to be inside and, you know, if they want to get outside, if they want any kind of recreation, from what I can foresee, and I don't have a crystal ball, but I can foresee that things are going to be very different this winter. And fortunately, it took me 4 years, Councillor Gillingham, to actually get this approval, the funding approved to have pathways and sidewalks cleared, a comparable amount of funding that basically got approved yesterday for the no fees for libraries, which I thought about it more last night. I thought, wow, interesting. One motion approved, 4 years, same value. But anyways, that's another topic I'm derailing. But you get the point. So what I'd like the department to do is just to put it on the record for the public what their plans are for this season for cleaning pathways, sidewalks. You know, it'll be the plan that we've agreed to that's in the policy, but I want to know if they're accommodating an increase in users of sidewalk and AT paths around schools, especially schools in the winter months, because as you know, we've got, you know, the province, the school divisions aren't running school buses. We've got kids walking, we've got cars driving, we've got high snow banks. There is a policy to clean snow sooner around schools. I just want to hear it on the record what they're going to be doing. I get hundreds of comments on Twitter, Facebook, you name it. And I'd like this to be out there so that people can hear it.
It's not bad, actually. Would you be open to a suggested maybe addition to it as well?
Oh yeah, bring it on.
That a corresponding was basically that we understand the corresponding corporate communications plan on snow clearing too.
Sure.
On AT paths, because I have a lot of residents in St. James that have really appreciated the, and kudos to you for your work on this, Councillor Lukes, over 4 years.
4 years, not one motion, 4 years.
I've certainly appreciated the change in snow clearing on AT paths. As of last year, I got a lot of positive feedback using the Sturgeon Creek Trail, the Yellow Ribbon Greenway Trail, and they're riding their bikes or they're walking all winter. And I agree, if there's ever a winter where we're going to need to make outdoor activity more accessible and safe, this is the winter. People need to get out, are going to need to get outside in the midst of this pandemic. So, finding out what the plans are for snow clearing, and then I think as council understanding what any corporate communication plan is related to how pathways will be cleared, I think will be important. So I certainly support this.
So what do you want to have? Do you want to write something into it or what?
Maybe, Madam Clerk, can I suggest and be it further resolved line?
You could change the resolve a little bit and say that the committee is recommending to IRPW that the public service be requested to provide a detailed verbal report at its November 10th meeting on the 2020 to 2021 snow clearing program and include the following. 1, plans to accommodate for an increase in users of sidewalks and active transportation pathways, particularly around schools during the winter months. And 2, the communication plan to citizens regarding the 2020 to 2021 snow clearing season.
Have you ever seen the old MASH show on Radar O'Reilly?
Yes. Yep.
That'd be excellent. I think, yep. I don't know if Councillor Lukes, if that's good for you.
No, that's great. And if Madam Clerk could just email that to me or to the committee today, that would be great. I'm getting questions already. People are worried. They're concerned. So am I. And to have a little bit of a spotlight on this really relevant topic at the Public Works Committee, I think would be a positive thing.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, I think it's a very good idea. I still want to know how Madam Clerk came up with that.
Yeah,
like that.
She's listening, that's what I say.
For a different day. But let's call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, carried. So, Madam Clerk, I have a per capita grant request that came in for the Charles Wood United Church. I can just approve that through, may as well get it on the record. It's $1,200 for their Christmas turkey campaign, which I think is going to be, I'm approving, so I'll take the chair.
Would you like to do that now or with the delegated authority of the city clerk?
Sure, I'll take the chair.
Okay.
The motion is before, sorry.
I would just need a motion to suspend the rules again.
Oh.
Thank you.
Okay, Counselor Klein moves suspension of the rules. All in favor? Aye.
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 Counselor Klein's motion is before us related to the per capita grant for
Charles Wood United Church. Every year they do their Charles Wood United Church Christmas cheer board hamper program. They put hampers together for families. The cost is $9,500, but they get $8,000 from the congregation and donations specific to this. Each year, the Charles Wood Tuxedo Westwood Ward has donated $1,000 over the last 15, 20 years. This year, we're upping it to $1,200. You know, I can't say enough about how fortunate we are to have the group there. So $1,200.
It's been moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried. I'll turn the chair back to Counselor Klein.
Thank you very much. And I guess we'll now move on to the public hearing, Madam Clerk.
Both registered participants are in the waiting room, so we'll admit them via Zoom if the committee is amenable to just proceeding with the hearing.
Yes.
Okay.
Did you read the open letter in the Free Press from the doctors? Is it a letter into the Free Press?
Officially. All right, I would like to officially call the public hearing for the Assiniboine Community Committee dated October 30th, 2020 to order.
In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. For a more in-depth overview of the public hearing process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the public hearing process brochure, which is available on the City Clerk's Department website. Please note that all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the hearing has concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item one is an application for a demolition at 527 Kelvin Boulevard under file DEMO 160998 of 2020. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you've been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching live on YouTube, please mute your audio on YouTube now. I'll turn it over to the planner for a brief overview of the application.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. So this is a demolition variance application at 527 Kelvin Boulevard. Kelvin Boulevard is in the Tuxedo neighborhood. It's just a little bit north of Grant Avenue. Under the city's development procedures bylaw, demolitions in residential areas where there is no associated building permit in place require this variance and this approval by this committee. So the applicant is proposing to demolish the house that is located on this property without a building permit in place, applying for a building permit associated with a new construction. They do intend to, according to the letter of intent, they do intend to build a new dwelling on this property. They're not planning to subdivide or do any other use that isn't permitted, just simply rebuild a new house down the road within a couple of years. And it's too early for them to finalize a plan and apply for a building permit. So as such, they are coming to this committee for approval of this demolition. The Urban Planning Division, the administration is recommending approval, subject to the condition that if no building is occurring within 12 months of the demolition, that the property be sodded with grass. So that is our recommendation.
So first up, we have the applicant.
I think Councilor Lukes had a question. I think you're on mute.
Oh, Councilor Lukes.
Thank you. Okay. Should I ask my question to the public service now or?
You can if you'd like, but you can ask questions of the public service at any time during the hearing. So.
Sure. I would just like to ask it now. So I've never seen the public service come forward and recommend the demolition of a dwelling without a building permit in my 6 years. Never. So why this one?
Well, I looking back on my time in the Assiniboia Planning District, I do know that we did recommend approval of a demolition permit, I believe, at 795 Buckingham Avenue in Charleswood. Another one close to this was on Glastonbury, 39, I believe that is the street name. This is also in the Tuxedo area. We did recommend approval in those cases, and the committee did concur with those recommendations.
What years were those?
These were I get a minute, I can find the dates of the hearings, but they were 2019, I believe. So fairly recently.
What are the addresses, please?
Let me just confirm it's 39 Glastonbury. I just want to confirm that is, yes, 39 Glastonbury, also in the Tuxedo ward. And
was it 2 years? Oh.
And the other one is 795. Yes, 795 Buckingham Road in Charleswood.
So I guess the question is, I've had ones in when I was in the St. Norbert ward, that the department wouldn't allow this to happen. So I'm just trying to understand what the criteria is where they allow some and not others.
Right. Yeah. And of course there have been other demolition applications throughout the city where the public service has recommended rejection. And there is criteria in the development procedures bylaw that are there's three criteria that any demolition would have to meet. And these are outlined in the report, but essentially it's that the demolition wouldn't create or increase the pressure to approve a new land use or intensification of the land. Doesn't create pressure against normal maintenance of the property, and doesn't create a visual detriment to the adjoining lands. In our view, this demolition application does satisfy those three criteria. And often, it's in cases where the proposal is, their intention is to one day, say, do a lot split or a subdivision or rezone to a higher intensity zoning category, and they are applying for a demolition permit, and that kind of puts the pressure on the administration and this committee to, you know, if there's a vacant lot, there's more pressure to do something with it. In this case, it's clear that we would not support any kind of subdivision here or any kind of rezoning of the land. And that is not the applicant's intention. Their intention is to just build another single family dwelling here, which they could do without any variance or any subdivision or any approval by this committee at all. So for those general reasons, we are supportive of it in this instance.
Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you. Just before we get to the applicant, and I thank the applicant for their patience, one question I would have is when I look at the report that accompanies this, page 6 on my screen of the report says, subject, intention to demolish a dwelling without a building permit for construction of a new building or renovation of the existing building or the establishment of some other permitted use being completed within 1 year in the case of one or two family dwelling, and in other cases, 2 years from the date. So you mentioned no intention of intensification. So I guess what I'm trying to get is your understanding of what the applicant is requesting here. Requesting a demolition with, and are they clear the intention, to your understanding, we're going to hear from the applicant in a bit, but your understanding is to build a new single family home there. There's not an intention to establish a two family dwelling. Is that right?
No, that is our understanding from speaking with the applicant and it's included in their letter of intent.
Okay.
Is that one day in the next few years, they will build one new single family dwelling, which is permitted at this location. It doesn't require a variance for the lot size or any other kind of variance.
Okay, I probably have other questions, but I'll wait to hear from the applicant. Okay.
Yeah. Councillor Lukes, any further questions right now?
No.
Thank you. Madam Clerk.
So first we have the applicant, Herman Lamb, who is joining us via Zoom. Mr. Lamb, if you could just unmute your microphone, please, and you have 10 minutes to proceed with your presentation.
I hope everybody can hear me okay. Not yes. Thank you. First off, thank you for your time. I wish I was a little bit more prepared. My wife and I are both physicians, and between her having to quarantine for 2 weeks and me taking care of the house and being on call for 4 nights of the last 7, I wish I had some slides to prepare, but I don't have anything, so I'm going to just go by talking. So a bit of history of us. We have moved into the neighborhood at 531 Kelvin Boulevard. We actually live next door to the property. We moved there in 2008. In 2006, we purchased a vacant lot that we subdivided into two lots that became 531 and 535 Kelvin Boulevard. And we built a house on 531 Kelvin Boulevard and have lived there since 2008. We really enjoy the neighborhood. We have no intention of moving. We built a very large house that is it's our first house, but it's a forever house, we think, until we need to downsize. Given that we've been financially secure, my wife's parents had moved away from Winnipeg to California, and in discussion in the last few years, we're kind of kicking ourselves a little bit for selling the lot at 535 Kelvin Boulevard. We thought we should have kept it and maybe used it for building a house at a later time. But when the opportunity came up to purchase 527 Kelvin Boulevard, discussed and had in terms of future planning thought that we would purchase it with the plans in the future of likely building another single family dwelling. We think our initial purpose for the house will be if we need to take care of my wife's parents who are getting up there in age, and if they need more help. Right now they're quite functional, but as they get older and might need help, we would hope to move them back to Winnipeg so that we can take care of them. That probably won't happen anytime soon. My father-in-law just turned 76, and my mother-in-law is only 65, and they're both young and healthy. So we don't have an imminent need to sort of take care of them. If anything, they're coming to help us with taking care of our children. So the opportunity came, we realized that our neighbors were an elderly couple and their son living in the house in 527 Kelvin Boulevard. Probably close to a year ago, the elderly couple was moved out of the house by another son to a condominium, and then the remaining son was living there for a little while. The plan, we later found out that the son that had moved the parents out actually had purchased the house from the parents and had owned it and had intention to sell it. When we had kind of been in conversation with the elderly couple that lived there, and we semi-seriously talked to them about purchasing the house in the event that they had moved out. And when the opportunity came in the spring, it was a lot quicker than we had expected, but it was there. So we sprung on it and purchased the house, taking possession around May. When we took possession, I don't think I did my homework properly. I thought that we could proceed with demolition right away without having to do, without having to rebuild. I didn't realize that there was that we had to apply for a variance, or there was that we needed a building permit in place. So for the first month or so when we had taken possession of the house, I kind of proceeded to do a little bit of demolition on my own to see what could be salvaged. So ended up removing most of the fixtures in the house. So all the electrical fixtures, the doors, and anything that was metal, we kind of took out of the house and had Habitat for Humanity come and pick it up. After that, we started the application for demolition permit probably around June or July, and then realized that our plans were not agreeable to, in that we needed to have this variance or we needed to have a building permit in place. After discussion for a while, we don't think that we would be able to rebuild a house within the 1 year time frame if we demolished right away. Because a few financial things, because the opportunity came up fairly quickly, I guess our finances are not ready to rebuild a new house. And we also don't need it right now. We're not sure what we would do if we had a house built within the year. I guess we considered the alternatives of leaving the house as it is. We feel that we would like to proceed with demolition, mostly for peace of mind. The main issues around it are the house is not habitable with all of the fixtures removed, and I don't want to put them back in. Also, during the application for demolition, we've had a few contractors come in for demolition and have discovered that the house is full of asbestos in all of the drywall joint compounds and the floors and some of the other walls. There are open areas that I kind of cut open in the walls that I don't want to go in anymore. The house is also full of cigarette smoke. During my month of working in there, my allergies were quite active, and found having to wear PPE in the house to keep myself from sneezing and things. So I don't like going in there. I do when I have to, but I don't like going in there to kind of maintain the house. In terms of the other things, small financial concerns, other than not being able to, afford to build a new house at this point, getting insurance for the house has been proven to be difficult. Finding insurance for a vacant house is a bit tricky. We also do worry, I mean, other than the insurance part of it, most of the insurance that we have is actually for liability insurance. The structure we feel is going to come down anyway. So if something were to happen to it, we'd be okay with it. Although the big thing I think more so is maybe safety. We do worry, like I said, I don't like going in there. Although we live next door, I don't go in there regularly. I guess we worry a little bit about the appearance of the place. I don't think I would be actively wanting to maintain a house that I don't live in and that is, I don't think, habitable. Hasn't happened yet, but I do wonder about like vandalism and other things. The third caveat about a visual detriment, I mean, we have to live with, we have to live next door to it too. So we'll be hoping to maintain it in a reasonable shape. I'd argue that if you leave a house there empty, I guess things like Halloween are coming up, the lights will be off. I can turn lights on. I wonder whether it'll be subject to vandalism at some point. I have heard in other situations, like one of our friends had mentioned, who is an architect, had mentioned like some of the houses on Corridon Avenue that, on Keniston Boulevard that were army houses that were torn down. On tearing them down, they noticed that they were sort of infested with rodents and things. I don't want to have to deal with that if it happens. I'd rather just have the house, or we'd rather just have the house demolished. As mentioned earlier, we certainly don't anticipate that it would cause pressure to use the property for anything else. We're not planning on building anything else other than a single family property. It's not at the end of a street. There's houses that have been there for a long time, including ours, that are established. There's three fences around the property. I can't see it being used for anything else other than a single family dwelling. It's too small to be subdivided, unlike our lot that we had purchased earlier. We don't think that it will create any increase in normal maintenance. We plan to leave the fences there. I guess we'll consider the recommendation about sodding it over if it's over a year, if we do have it more than a year. The last thing we had going forward, I thought in terms of our process earlier, we thought that we could proceed with demolition without the permit. It seemed like there were several vacant lots on our street at various times since we've moved there. There was ours, which we think was vacant for many, many years. I acknowledge that it wasn't a demolished house, but it was just a treat lot. A few houses down at 519 Kelvin Boulevard, there was an empty lot that sat there for many, many years as well. Again, acknowledged probably not a demolished lot, but it was just recently built on. And then we think that 410 Kelvin Boulevard on our street as well sat empty for quite a long time as well. It did look like there was a driveway there, so there must have been a house there that was there before. So that's one of the reasons that we kind of proceeded the way we did.
Yeah. Go ahead. Madam Clerk, go ahead. Dr. Lamb, do you need much more time, sir?
No, I think that is about, those are the main points I wanted to get across. And with that, I'll stop. Thank you for your time.
No, listen, first and foremost, thank you for coming here today. But thank you to you and your wife for the work you do on the front line. I know I don't get the opportunity to say thanks to a lot of the medical professionals in our city and our first responders, but every time I do have the fortunate opportunity to talk to one, I always want to take that little bit of time to thank you for what you're doing, and thank you for your continued efforts, and hopefully we'll all get it and stay indoors and wear a mask for as long as we need to, so that we can all get through this. So thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
I believe some of my colleagues will have some questions. I do as well. Madam Clerk has something to add.
I think there's been a recess requested, or?
I believe Councillor Lukes has a matter that must be attended to.
I apologize. I must leave. I have to leave to attend to a matter that is very unexpected.
Yep.
So, and not that I'll be there to vote, but I am supportive of this. I've heard what Dr. Lamb has said. I've looked at the area. I've looked at the other two. I won't be able to vote, but I'm supportive.
You know what, Councillor Lukes, Madam Clerk, Councillor Gillingham and I are ready to vote.
There's still another individual registered to speak to this item.
Okay. In support or?
Just for information, as I understand it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can Councillor Lukes, can we do it in 2 minutes? Like within 2 minutes, can we get it all?
Can Councillor Lukes leave us, or what's the protocol?
If there's a recess needed, we should recess just so that everyone is hearing the same information. if
you have quorum.
Yep, you can certainly leave, but just in terms of coming back.
No, I'm going to leave.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, Council. Thank you.
I apologize again. Okay. I'm sorry.
No, it's all right. Hope everything will be okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, we can carry on.
So we do have a couple of questions. So Dr. Lamb will have to stay on the line, correct?
Yes, he can stay in the meeting and he'll have the chance for a rebuttal as well.
Thank you.
So we can proceed then. That we have no one else registered in support of the application, but just as a double check, we should maybe call out for anyone else in support.
Go ahead.
So is anyone in the gallery in support? No one's here.
Look around. Hang on a second, though. You never know.
We have no one registered in opposition to this application, but just as a double check, is there anyone here in opposition to the application? All right. So next is Ben Buchwald, who is registered for information with respect to the application.
Yes. Hello. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes, sir. Welcome.
Okay. Thank you very much. Hello, Herman. How are you?
Very good. Thank you.
Good. Okay. Thanks for taking the time to hear my question. So I live at 527 Kelvin, which is the property right next to the property that's going to be demolished. I certainly don't want to stand in the way of this house being torn down, but I do have some questions and some concerns, and just want to make sure that they are addressed and that they're heard by the committee before any vote is put forward. So with respect to what Herman or Dr. Lamb had mentioned with some of the other properties like 410 Kelvin Boulevard that sat vacant for I believe around 4 years after they knocked it down. And it did become quite an eyesore on the property. There were a lot of weeds growing there. It was very visually or aesthetically unappealing. To look at, a lot of dust and debris was building up there over time, and it did get to a point where it had sat there for many years with no plans for development. And I know the neighbors on both sides started to have some of their own concerns with privacy, with matters of wind blowing into their yard quite a lot, and dust and debris blowing into their yard. And I just want to make sure that there are some conditions set on this so that if this is going to be an extended period of time, that indeed there is some assurance that the lot will be properly landscaped and maintained after a 12-month period if there's no immediate plan to build, and that there's consideration to the aesthetics and our own privacy as well, because now it's a fairly big lot compared to other neighborhoods. So there is now sort of, once that house comes down, there'll be kind of from our own backyard a direct sort of view to the street, or more noise traffic from the street and less privacy in our backyard. And then also all of the things that the other neighbors have mentioned with those vacant lots as well, with debris and privacy. The neighbors who are next to the lots where there were no houses for several years also indicated that there were several times where people were dumping garbage in those areas, and it became quite an eyesore. So I just want to make sure that if this is happening, that there is some condition on sort of a time limit and the aesthetics of the property. And then just one more thing with respect to the two properties that Dr. Lamb had mentioned on our block that were sort of treed areas. Those were never developed at any point. The lots that they bought from the house on Park Boulevard, which is my cousin's house. And it was always a forest from the time that Tuxedo was developed. But the lot right next to me, where there was a treed forest as well, or two over, I should say, they started to cut down that forest a few years ago to build, and they canceled the plan to build. Not Dr. Lamb, but the owners of that property. And that also became quite a sort of a weeded area and really a rough looking area. And our neighbors to the north of us said that it did bring in a lot of wind, a lot of dust, a lot of debris into their yard, and it was not that comfortable of a situation. So I'll just end on this point that, you know, I don't object to the house being torn down, But I'm concerned about the number of years that this may sit, and that there are conditions set to ensure that it's well maintained, well taken care of, and we don't sort of see just a construction fence or a chain link fence on that property to prevent people from going in, but that it is almost becomes an extension of their property and maintained as if it was part of their property.
Thank you very much. I think you presented a very reasonable request and points. We do have a couple of questions for you, Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure if you did see the administrative report, but I think I believe it will address the very concern you've raised here. And I appreciate you've raised it. A condition, I'm reading from the report on page 9, a condition placed on approval is recommended by the Urban Planning Division, which will ensure that the demolition site will be properly landscaped with grass should development permits not be proceeded with within 12 months of the demolition date. So I think what is, just to reiterate, what is before us today in the administrative report is basically that if the house is demolished, it can't, the lot cannot, sit kind of in a demolished state, but certainly that at minimum sod or grass would be placed over the site and over the property if there's, no new building that arises within 12 months. So would that condition assist to alleviate some of the concerns you raised?
Yeah, I think it would. But what it doesn't raise is putting up a fence as well. So one of the problems, even if it's nicely maintained, that deals with the aesthetics. On the other two lots on Kelvin, what ended up happening was that even though they were empty lots, they started to become these places where the neighbor right to the north of us had a vacant lot next to him. It was a treed forested area that had been extended from Park Boulevard and had never been developed when Kelvin first got developed, Kelvin Boulevard. And when those trees were knocked down, it did become a place where people were dumping things. He talked to me about how sometimes there were teenagers who would have parties in there on that lot after they would leave a house party. So I do think that a combination of some sort of aesthetic condition to maintain the lot and the grounds and make sure it's sodded, as I did see in the document, that's great. But I would also like to see something addressing security in that there is some type of perhaps like a wooden fence separating the backyard there so that there's not a big open area right through to the back. I'm concerned about the length of time that it might be. It might be 2 years, it might be 5 years. Is there any condition to the number of years that it can sit empty? Because there is also, from our own standpoint, the issue of our own privacy in the backyard and the wind that does pick up, according to the other neighbors, that blows in, and the noise from the street at the front, having not have a house that we're used to, giving some of that privacy. So is there any condition to the number of years, because it's my understanding it could be several years before any plans are in place, perhaps many years. And I just want to know if that's been considered or if there is no condition on that.
Exactly. Just my follow-up. And I think you did, Councillor Klein would just clarify. Yeah. So I think I appreciate those questions. Those are questions that, though, as Councillor Klein just pointed out to me, though, you probably can't ask directly. We'll take the questions, and those questions we will raise today with both the applicant and the our administration here, just to see if there's anything regarding timelines, and then also regarding securing the site. So thank you for that.
Okay, great. Any other questions
now? Not at this time.
Dr. Lamb, you have both of you are welcome to please stay on the line or ask to stay on the line, because you'll have an opportunity to rebut. Is that correct, Madam Chair? Madam Clerk?
The applicant has an opportunity to speak to in rebuttal to comments made.
Okay, thank you very much. So I have a couple of questions, first of all, of the public service. So to answer the questions that Councillor Gillingham is going to ask, I have the one. The 12 months before the saw, depending on when the demolition does occur, you know, given the fact it's in a residential area, is that not considered a fairly long stretch of time?
Well, they have 12 months. Like if you were to demolish a house and you wanted to rebuild right away, and so you got your building permit in as well as your demolition permit, you would have, in that case, you would have 12 months to start building. Right. So you could demolish this fall and then do the building next summer. So 12 months is not, I wouldn't say typical in practice, but that is what is permitted. So
what's typical in practice?
Well, typically, I think, people want to, I mean, it depends on, like a builder's timelines, and, they may want to get the demolition out of the way and, in fall, and then have a vacant site over winter and then, start digging in spring kind of thing, or they might do it all in one shot. With any demolition that occurs, the site needs to be cleared of debris, so you can't just leave pipes or bricks or anything sitting in the pile, and it all needs to be leveled so that it's not a safety concern. Aesthetically, over time, it doesn't really look that great. So that's why the condition is anything longer than usual, longer than 12 months, they would at that point need to grass it over, either with sod or seeds.
Okay, thank you for that. Councillor Gilligan?
Yeah, thank you. Just another question, and I guess I could ask the applicant, Mr. Lamb, this question, but maybe I'll ask Public Service. Looking at the site, 527 Kelvin on Google Maps, there's some very nice and established trees on the lot, according to, now I don't know what the date of this street view picture is, but at the time of the street view picture, May 2015, and I don't know if they're maybe updated in 2020, I don't know if it's changed or not, if those trees are still there. Is there any way to ensure that the trees are not removed or damaged in the demolition? Can we put a condition on? I get it. Without maybe the question maybe moved, because maybe Dr. Lamb is going to say, well, I'm not touching the trees anyways, but maybe I'll ask you whether we can place a condition on if necessary regarding the trees.
Well, I believe it's shown on the agenda for this meeting, but the applicant did provide a like an applicant, it's a demolition or removal permit application form. I'm just gonna see. Yeah, it is attached to this report on the agenda. It's just on grid paper showing the location of the driveway and house and the trees that are on the property.
Sorry, I hadn't scrolled that far down into the report. I missed that last page. Yeah. I see it now. It's basically a drawn out.
Yeah, and the trees that are currently in the front yard are shown as being removed. That is something that they can do. I've looked at this on Google Street View and our mapping systems, and it does look like a large old tree that seems to be, according to Street View, thriving. It may be that this committee could put on a committee condition that an arborist report be completed, because I wouldn't be able to say with any certainty whether the demolition process would have an impact on the health of that tree, if it has to go or if it's just kind of an ask.
Okay. Thank you. Maybe when the time comes to ask the applicant, maybe I'll pose the question to him related to the trees.
Yeah, fair enough. Thank you, sir. Dr. Lamb, if I may, first of all, you heard a few comments from the other delegate. Is there something you would like to say with respect to what he had mentioned as concerns?
Well, I don't think that it'll be in disrepair. We live next door too, so we have to look at it every day too. So in terms of our specific plans for what we're going to do with the lot, we're not a huge fan of sod. We might end up like we would like it to be something that we'll be able to use and look at and be nice, but I don't know if we're sold on just sodding the whole thing over. But maybe we could come up with a plan that will be sort of still visually okay and not involving sod. It may still be sod. We're not sure yet. We haven't really planned it out that far. In terms of security with the fence, we've also discussed it, although we're not really sure what we want to do with it yet. There is a very nice apple tree in the backyard, which we intend to keep. The neighbors also had a fairly good recreational garden in the back, which we're taking advantage of using the space, and we may end up using more of that. So if we were to do that, we'd probably want it to be a secure area rather than people coming in and taking our vegetables and fruit and stuff. That apple tree last year produced several hundred pounds of apples that we intend to keep. In the front yard, the trees closest to the street, we intend to keep. There is a very, very large tree that's very close to the driveway and very close to the house that I don't think we'll be able to salvage, and we would not have plans to keep it anyways for the new build. Just it's probably going to be I think that we would probably be building onto that area. So I think that how that tree would have to go. There's one that's closer to 531 Kelvin Boulevard that I can't really remember what it looks like. I don't remember it being a very big tree. It seems to be a little bit out of the way. I did put on our tentative plan when I made this several months ago that we'd remove it, although I guess we could look at it again. In terms of a timeline for building the house, I don't think we can commit to anything. I'm sorry about that, but it does depend on what happens in the future. We've discussed that it could be sooner if Trump wins. My mother-in-law really wants to come back, but I can't really commit to a timeline, I'm sorry. I don't think it'll be like 20 years, but because we'll be really old by then and retired by then, but it'll be sometime in the next few years. That's all I can really say.
Okay. Thank you. Councilor Gillingham, do you have a couple questions?
No, I appreciate the answers. Thank you. No, I'm good.
I think, in speaking with Councillor Gillingham and taking everything into consideration, and I certainly understand the desire to have your own, the resident for their own landscaping plan. I think it's fair and reasonable, though, to look at the character of the neighborhood and the fact that it's residential. Can we request, and we'll get, I'll pose it to you as well, Dr. Lamb, that we leave the tree, the tree directly there right now during demolition, that stays there and after. But then when building comes or permits are taken out, then it can be addressed at that time.
That could be, that could be included as a condition that the large tree be maintained, yeah. As a city, we don't have control over ultimately what a landowner does with the trees on their private property. Now that I think of it, we do often in the case of some infill projects where existing trees are addressed as a concern, we do make a recommend condition that an arborist report be completed and submitted to the director of PPD. And so we can look at the viability of a tree in that sense. So it may be, it,
my understanding is that it may be a little difficult to make a condition that a tree shall be maintained during the demolition process or something like that, because we don't have the capability to hold them to that, basically.
Mr. Gillingham?
I guess maybe I'll just ask Dr. Lamb straight up, is there any possibility of keeping the large tree, not removing it during demolition, and then depending on what the future site plan is, and the landscaping plan that would come forward in consultation with the department, maybe incorporating that large tree into a future site plan? I appreciate every property owner has property rights. I certainly respect that. To be candid, we, as you have probably seen in the city in the last several years, we're just having such a struggle with our urban canopy, and whether it's disease of Dutch elm trees or now the emerald ash borer beetle, and 12 months ago, the October storm, our trees have just taken a beating. And so any tree that is in good shape or looks to be healthy or seems to be healthy, we just have we try to do all we can to preserve all the trees we can preserve. Again, respecting the fact that as a property owner, you do have your property rights. So I'm just asking though whether it's a possibility for you to give consideration to preserving that tree at this point, and kind of demolishing around the tree. That's a question to you.
I'll have to talk to my wife about it. I think we had the intention of that tree coming down. I think our neighbors actually were wanting to tear it down earlier. It's just they didn't think they could afford to remove it because they thought it was like kind of bringing up their driveway and things like that. So I'd imagine it's, I think the roots are kind of into the house. So, I don't know if I can commit. I'll have to talk to my wife about it. So sorry about that.
Fair response. Thank you for your answer.
Okay. I assume that if you get approval, Dr. Lamb, you would go ahead and do the demolition this winter?
I don't know. I kind of thought that I had kind of given up for this year because I thought we were going to get it done in the summer. I'll have to talk to the demolition companies as to what's best. I'd have some reservations about leaving it kind of for the winter, like kind of full of snow, but I'll have to talk to them if it's approved. So.
Okay. In the 12 months is for the landscaping plan, to have it fully landscaped, that'll be part of the rule. Right, it won't be. It's not a suggestion. It has to be there.
It will be a condition on the variance, and so it will be required. If it's not done, and the neighbor were to notice that and call the city, then that would be an enforcement issue.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's
fair enough.
Good. It's required.
Take the chair when you want.
Yep. Thank you very much. Okay. Councillor Gillingham, maybe you would like to take the chair.
We should just formally allow Mr. Lamb to speak in rebuttal to comments made.
Sure.
If he wishes to.
Good idea. Mr. Dr. Lamb, your opportunity to make a formal rebuttal. No new information, but I'll let our clerk give the full details. Madam Clerk.
You can go ahead. And if you wish to, you can speak in rebuttal to comments made, but no new information is permitted.
No, I don't have any more comments. Thank you.
Okay.
I'll take the chair then at this time, and I will turn it over. Let me get to my procedure here. Turn it over to Councillor Klein for the motion.
Hang on a second. I got it.
Yeah, perfect.
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried.
I move that the receipt of the public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye. Gary?
I move that the criteria under Part 3, Section 6 of the Development Procedures Bylaw Number 160, 2011 are...
Oh, sorry, Counselor. I think there's just updated wording there for you on the page.
Oh, yes. 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 Change the bylaw as of yesterday. So noted that at yesterday's City Council meeting, we changed the bylaw so that I now move that the criteria under Part 9, Section 45.3 of the Development Procedures Bylaw 104-2020 are satisfied.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Carried.
And I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Carried. Madam Clerk.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Lamb. Appreciate your time. And I think...
I'll move adjournment.
We need someone to move for adjournment. So moved, all in favor, aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, carried.